Tracy or myself, let's try to make this happen. Obviously, with DDS happening this week, this may not be our best opportunity, but when you've got some time available, talk to Tracy. We may try to start it this week, and I'm guessing there'll be some work to do next week as well. Thank you.
I was just thinking, there's the craft time and the game activity. Kids and I guess is ready to go.
That sounds like fun.
Are you kids excited about that idea?
Yeah.
They have no idea what we're talking about, so that's good.
All right, October 21st, that's next Saturday, after VBS wraps up, we are having a chili cook-off. So if you think you make the best pot of chili, this is your chance to come and show it off. And we are going to be giving a trophy to the winner, but we will not announce the winner until next Sunday morning. So now, if you're not going to enter chili, you're still welcome to come and eat chili. I have a feeling we're going to have plenty of it. We might have some cases of Tums to give away, too, after the fact. We'll see. October 29th is our Costume Sunday. We're inviting all kids to come to church in their costume. Remember, it's church, right? Teens, you can come as well, but remember, it's church. Adults, I can't stop you one way or the other, but remember, it's church, okay? But adults, we are asking you all to bring candy and bring lots and lots and lots of candy. Again, we want to send the kids home with so much candy that I get complaint letters for the next 3 months. And I'll be the ones writing most of them, those letters. So that's the 29th. Also on the 29th, we are having our fifth Sunday Singspiration. It's going to be here at our church at 6 p.m. We are going to have sandwiches, right? We're providing the sandwiches or finger foods, and then the other churches are going to bring the other stuff. But we're in charge of the finger foods and the sandwich stuff. So, let's see. Before we go into worship and before we do our meet and greet time, I just want to take a minute and do something. I said last week that everybody here is important. Do you remember that? Probably not. That's okay. I barely remembered it, too. But I want to do something. So if you're a church board member, would you please stand up? If you are a Sunday school teacher, would you please stand up? If you help with the worship team, would you please stand up? Vicky is standing over there. She's just. All right. I had to be a little mean today. If you've been helping with any of the work or building projects, would you please stand up? If you're helping with the sound and the technical stuff, would you please stand up? If you're helping with the compassionate ministries, either by running one or putting stuff in the blessing box, would you please stand up? If you show up or pray for the church, if you're here, if you're a kid, would you please stand up? Yeah, and Haley, I want Haley to wave like a crazy person because she's helping with our kids. No. But see, I want you to look around the room for a second. There's a reason why we're all standing, is because it takes all of us working for the kingdom together to make it, to fulfill the mission that Jesus has given us. We're working together to do this, and I'm so excited that we get to do it together, right? So this time, I'm gonna let you greet one another for a few minutes here, and then we'll begin worship here in just a few seconds.
Jason.
Yes.
God. Isn't it wonderful? Isn't it wonderful to be able to be in the house of God, to be able to fellowship together, to be able to enjoy this day that God has given us? So I got one more announcement, and then we'll officially be done with announcements. Jason, Nicole, if y'all could stand either here, here, front, stand somewhere, I'll go to you. So on behalf of the church, we want to thank you for your dedication and your service, not only to our church, but to the community around our church. It's a blessing that you all have come to us, and we're so thankful for you all. All right, I know y'all were just standing and mingling and having a good time, but why don't we stand again and have even more fun time? So we're going to sing Living by Faith. If you want to get your hymn, it's number 566. And we're going to sing as loud as we can.
I care not today what tomorrow may bring, in shadow or sunshine or rain. The Lord knows I ruleth o'er everything, and all of my worry is vain. Living by faith in Jesus above, trusting.
Thank you for helping me, David. So something that I would like to start doing is having more people come up and lead worship as well besides me. They can do it with me, or if they want, they can do it by themselves. I strongly encourage, if anybody is interested in doing that, please let me, Jason, or anybody a part of the worship team, just let us know if you would like to do that. Because I'm going to be honest with you, there's some times where I would just like to be out in the congregation and be able to worship. You know, I am worshiping now, don't think that. But it's a different experience when you're able to be out with the community and be able to sing with them. And I get tired of hearing my voice a lot too. Thank you. So this next song, it's a contemporary song. It's called Build My Life. I know a lot of y'all just sat back down. If you want, you can stand back up. Or if you want to sit down, that's fine too. It's whatever is comfortable with you all. All I ask is listen to the words. You know, we're here to praise and worship God, you know. And that's what it's all about, you know. Worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those.
we go to prayer today, we have some prayer needs. We're going to remember Sheila on Friday. She's going in for eye surgery, right? So be remembering Sheila. Remember Nell and her sisters today. Her brother-in-law is in the hospital in Lexington, and that's where Nell is today. They're going to see him. So be praying for them and that family. And I feel like I'm forgetting another one. Oh, Bo and Reva. Be praying for Bo and Reva. They've been battling with COVID. Bo got it first and gave it to Reva, then Reva gave it back to him. So be praying for that family, that the Lord helps them through this time. Are there any other prayer needs this morning that... Anybody else this morning? Definitely remember. Jaden. Aqua's mother's having heart surgery this week, right? So we'll be praying for her as well. Aqua's mom is going in for heart surgery this week, so be praying for Aqua's mom. And the boys, yes. Yep. Anybody else? Definitely. Anybody else? Well, Christian's going to get a baptism by fire here. As we get ready to go to prayer, I want to sing, there's just something about that name. Is that okay? I want to sing that together just to remind us that these requests that we just shared with one another, we're lifting them up to Jesus. Just like the scripture tells us, he tells us to cast our burdens, our worries, anxieties, even our sin at his feet. And so we're going to sing this together. And if there's just something on your heart today and you want to bring it to the Lord, you can bring it forward. You can pray in your seat where you're at. And I also encourage us all, let's be praying for Vacation Bible School this week. To me, it's not about the number of kids we have. It's about the kids that get introduced to Jesus, some of them for the first time. And I'm sure there are folks in this room that without Vacation Bible School, you wouldn't be here today. Because of what the Lord did in your life through Vacation Bible School. So as we sing this song, if there's a need, come forward. If you feel led to come pray for Vacation Bible School, come forward. We'll enter this season of prayer after we sing this chorus together. Thank you.
There's more than just something about that name. Amen. There is everything about that
Amen.
Name.
Amen. Let's pray together. Lord, so much in our life and in this world is temporary. The things that we love and we enjoy, Lord, they don't last forever. They change, or they go away, or something happens. Lord, the people that we love and we associate with, sometimes we drift apart, sometimes they move away, but Lord, it changes. And other times, Lord, when we're going through the darkest of night and we're dealing with the problems and situations that come our way, we hold on to the hope knowing that someday this too will pass. But there's one thing, there's one person that will never change, that will never fade away, that will never disappear, and that is you, Lord. That is Jesus, and that's the power in your name, that is the promise in your name, that is the healing in your name, Lord, that the power in your blood, those things will never fade away or disappear. And Lord, you loved us enough to offer that gift of eternity to us too. Lord, so as we're going through this journey of life together, we are blessed that you have brought us together in this place, in this community, in this fellowship for the time that we're in right now. Because, Lord, as we're waiting for forever to happen, Lord, it's so much better. It's so much sweeter when we're journeying with the people around us, people who love us and care about us, people who are there for us. God, I'm grateful for the Ravenna Church of the Nazarene and the people here. And Lord, you know there are needs in our midst. I think of this family that Sheila's praying for, and this friend, the loss of her husband, and the situations that are going there. God, we lift them up to you, trusting that you can work in this situation, that you can provide comfort, that you can provide direction, Lord, and that you can work in this other situation that's going on as well. There is no situation that is impossible for you. We think of Brother Toller as he's continuing through his treatment and through his journey, God. And yes, we know that there's medicine that helps, but you know there's been some problems and things that they're trying to get that figured out. But God, we know that his situation is not impossible for you. That you're working, that you're stirring in his life and in his family's life. So Lord, we ask that you continue to give them your strength and your comfort and endurance as they go through this. We pray for Aqua and the boy's mom. It's scary when our parents are facing something difficult, especially if it's heart surgery, God. We ask that you would put your arms around them, that you would help the doctors and the nurses as they perform the surgery, and that you would be with their mom as she goes through this time of healing. We trust your surgery to her, Lord. We trust Sheila's surgery on Friday to you, Lord. We're thankful for the medicine and the technology that's able to help us with things, Lord, But Lord, I pray that you would give her courage and boldness and assurance that you are going to be with her through this and that you're going to be with her as she's healing. I pray for this friend of Jane's that's just been diagnosed with cancer, Lord, and it seems like an impossible situation, but Lord, there's nothing that's impossible for you. And I pray, Lord, that in this time that you would raise up somebody in her life, somebody in her community, somebody from a local church, somebody that she can count on, that will be there for her as she journeys through this, Lord. Lord, we know you're there with her, but would you send her somebody to be your hands and feet? Lord, I think of the people that you blessed me with the opportunity to be able to pray with outside of our church this week. You know the needs that were presented and the things that were going on in their lives, God, and we trust those things to you, knowing that you're working and that you're stirring. We ask, God, that you would continue to be with us through the remainder of this service, that you would bless Nicole as she brings us the word. It's in the name of Jesus I pray. Amen. At this time, I'm going to invite the ushers to come forward. We're going to take God's tithe and our offering.
would you pray for our offering this morning?
Good morning. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn to the book of 2 Timothy. And over the last couple of weeks, I have had the privilege of teaching those two young ladies there in Sunday school. Hey, Jaden, can you do me a favor and tell the congregation what we've been talking about? Say it louder. We've been talking about the importance of reading the Bible. And I realized the importance of kind of instilling that at a young age. I've kind of always realized that. I started reading the Bible when I was 8 years old, and I used to listen to it on audio cassette and fall asleep listening to it, to the point that, like, by the time I was 10, I had the whole New Testament memorized. I couldn't tell you chapter or verse, but I could tell you what it said. That was in the old, terrible version of the NIV, though, so. But I grew to love the Bible, and the reason why, what reminded me, though, is of the importance of instilling that love of Scripture at a young age was a video I saw. And the video had the title, Jesus Too Woke for Christians. Now, obviously, that is not the case. But what drove the video to have this title was the fact that it was a video of an interview from a denominational leader, not the Church of the Nazarene, but another well-known denomination. I'm not going to get into who or what denomination, but he resigned from his position because of a common issue that had been brought to him by the pastors of his denomination. And the issue was the pastors would be getting up and preaching, and particularly the words in red. And they would be talking about loving our enemies or turning the other cheek. And the congregants would come up to the pastors afterwards and be like, "Where did you get those woke talking points?" And the pastor would explain, those are literally the words of Jesus. I'm just quoting Jesus. And they would respond, well, that doesn't apply now. It doesn't work anymore. That's weak. And the sad thing about that is although that's the first time I've ever heard that about the words in red, it's not the first time I've heard parts of Scripture discounted even within the church. I grew up in a congregation that valued the New Testament over the Old. And that's not uncommon within Christendom. We love reading about Jesus, and we love the epistles. But we neglect the Old Testament because those don't apply anymore. Those stories are outdated. They just don't apply. And now, by some, even the Gospels now are seen as irrelevant and no longer apply. But I want to ask us, or I want us to ask, what does the Bible say about this? In 2 Timothy chapter 3, starting in verse 14, it says, "You, however, must continue in the things you have learned and are confident about. You know who taught you, and how from infancy you have known the holy writings, which are able to give you wisdom for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. Every scripture is inspired by God and useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the person dedicated to God may be capable and equipped for every good work." Continuing in verse 4, it says, "I solemnly charge you before God and Christ Jesus, who is going to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom, preach the message. Be ready, whether it is convenient or not, to reprove, rebuke, exhort with complete patience and instruction. For there will come a time when people will not tolerate sound teaching. Instead, following their own desires, they will accumulate teachers for themselves, because they have an insatiable curiosity to hear new things, and they will turn away from hearing the truth. But on the other hand, they will turn aside to myths." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now, I just love when technology edits images. Now here's the thing about this passage. The scriptures Paul is referring to are the Old Testament scriptures, the ones that I grew up having disregarded. The Old Testament is what Paul is referring to when he is referring to all scriptures, because none of the New Testament had been canonized yet. This did not exist. The Gospels were not even viewed as scripture yet. They were accounts, but they weren't scripture. But that doesn't mean that the New Testament from Matthew to Revelation is not inspired scripture. There's a reason it was placed in the canon. So what does Paul mean when he says every scripture? This is where he's going to edit. He's going to drive me nuts. All means all. All scripture. That means the Old Testament, the law, the history, poetry, the prophets, all of it. That means the parts of the prophets that step on our toes and we view as offensive or humanist or whatever, that's inspired scripture. That means that the law that some view as too strict, that is inspired scripture. That means that the cries out of David in the Psalms, where he is screaming at God in anger and in agony, that is inspired scripture. And the stories in Judges that are filled with gore and heartbreaking accounts, that is inspired scripture. In the New Testament, that's inspired scripture. The Gospels, the Acts, the the epistles, Revelation, all of it. There is absolutely nothing in the Bible that is not there for a reason. And I'm going to say right now, Jesus is not too woke for me. But why did Paul feel the need to tell Timothy that all scripture is inspired? It wasn't that Timothy doubted the inspiration of scripture. I mean, here's the thing about Timothy. He grew up on his grandmother's and his mother's knees, hearing scripture being taught. The whole reason Timothy was at the church in Ephesus was because his mom and grandma invested spiritually in his life. They raised him on scripture, and he knew that it was inspired. The issue Timothy struggled with was the usefulness of it. You see, a lot of people will say, oh, I know scripture, I know the Bible, but will turn around and live life a completely different way. I mean, we say we know what holiness means because of scripture, but do we live it? The point that Paul was trying to focus on was not the inspiration, because that was kind of a given. It was the usefulness. It was the purpose of scripture. See, unlike other books, this is not here just to read and then put it back on a shelf. There is a purpose to this book. There is a reason why we should be reading it. It's not just to learn about creation and how God created the world in 7 days. It's not just to learn about how God saved the people from slavery in Egypt. It's not just an account of Jesus coming to earth and dying for our sins. There's so much more to it. It's not just a book of information. It has information. Information's there. But what good is information if we don't apply it? So Paul was telling Timothy that this is more than just the information. That there is a usefulness to it. So what's scripture for? What's the purpose? The purpose is to teach. It's to reprove. It's to correct. And it's to train us in righteousness. So that the person dedicated to God may be capable and equipped for every good work. The thing is, to teach, it's not just standing in front of a room like I am now and explaining the information. Teach directly translates to doctrine. Teaching, when it's referring to scripture teaching us, it's referring to the doctrines that we hold in our faith. The Apostles' Creed. The fact that we believe in God the Father, Almighty Maker of heaven and earth. That we believe in Jesus, his Son. That we believe in the Trinity, the Holy Spirit. That we believe in the church. Because it's all here in Scripture. That's what it means to teach. To reproof. It means to prove or to test. So when Jason and I are up here and we're preaching something and you're like, oh, that doesn't sound right. That's what this is for. Open it up. Test it. Test what we're saying. We want that because it means that you're digging into Scripture. It's to test the teachings that people are telling us. And it's to correct. Now, one thing I want to point out about the word correct is it's very easy for us to get, like, offended about a teaching and then we want to correct, but we correct in a hateful way. That's not the type of correct that it's referring to here. The word actually translates to show honor. So basically, it's like if, I don't know, if that candle fell over. And in order to correct it, I would carefully pick it up and put it upright so that way it's not going to break. It's to show honor, it's to show respect to whatever has fallen aside. And Scripture's purpose is to train us in righteousness. To cultivate our minds and our morals. To increase in our virtue. And to chastise the evil that might be within us. To train us in righteousness into whatever image is acceptable to God. Not to us, to God. That is the purpose. And the purpose is so that we who are dedicated to God may be capable and equipped for every good work. And that's another thing. It's calling us to do good work, which this church is doing. As this is my own little rabbit trail, but that is one thing that Jason and I are constantly in awe of. It's the good work that we see each and every one of you doing. So that is Scripture's purpose. So what is our responsibility? In chapter 4, it says, I solemnly charge you before God and Christ Jesus, who is going to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom, preach the message, be ready whether it is convenient or not, reprove, rebuke, exhort, with complete patience and instruction. So we're supposed to preach the message. We're supposed to be proclaiming the gospel. Wherever we go, we're supposed to be sharing the love of Jesus. That is our responsibility. Be ready when it is even when it's not convenient, to reprove, to correct, to refute what's wrong, and to expose what's wrong with doctrine. Not, we're supposed to recognize false teaching and correct it, but correct it with care and gentleness. To rebuke with care and gentleness. And to exhort. And this is another area where sometimes we fall short. We get pretty dedicated to the reproving and rebuking side of things. but to exhort. Scripture is meant to encourage. Do we use Scripture to encourage? Scripture is meant to provide comfort to the broken. Do we do that? Scripture is meant to instruct. Do we do that? There is positive in Scripture, and yet, unfortunately, the world around us sees the Bible as something negative because that's the only thing we've shown them. Why do you think it's banned from schools? It's kind of hard to advocate for a book that everybody around us only hears negative from. It's meant to encourage. And that our responsibility is to find what we can encourage and not just rebuke. Find how we can comfort and not just reproof. We're supposed to do all of that with patience and instruction. Are we patient? I am not. I am the first to admit I am not. I can't tell you how many times I've read headlines like what I showed up there. And Jason and I will be driving down the road and I just go on a rant. I go on a rant of just total frustration and anger that somebody would dare say something that appalling. I'm not patient. But God help me, because I need to be. And all of this should be with the purpose of instructing, not with the purpose of condemning. We want to point out that certain things are wrong, but we always follow it up with, so you're going to hell. You're not honoring God. So you're going to hell. It's like, that's not the purpose of rebuking. That's not the purpose of reproving. The purpose is instruction. It's to teach us. It's to teach our brothers and sisters. I don't know about you, but I don't learn very well when somebody is screaming at me, telling me everything I'm doing wrong. I shut down. I close myself off. How much of the time am I closing other people off because of how I respond when they're wrong? This is our responsibility. Preach the message and to be ready in season and out of season to reprove, rebuke, exhort with complete patience and instruction. And the reason we're supposed to do these things is because there will be a time when people will not tolerate sound teaching. There will be a time when Jason and I will be up on stage in front of a church. I do not believe it'll ever be this one, but we will be up on stage in front of a church and somebody will say, I will not tolerate that sound teaching. Instead, they will follow their own desires and they will accumulate teachers for themselves, people that say what they want to hear. Because they have an insatiable curiosity to learn, hear new things, not the truth found in Scripture. There will come a time when God's word, including the words in red, are rejected in favor of personal opinion. And when scriptural instruction is labeled as a political agenda. There will come a time when they will turn away from the truth because the truth is too offensive. They will see it as too fundamentalist or too woke. It will be too rough or too weak. It will be too much of something. Scripture will be too much of something, and that something, whatever it is enough for them to disregard everything. And I've seen it on all sides of the aisle. I've seen it where churches reject this because the truth of Scripture is too fundamentalist and it doesn't apply to today. It's too strict. I know a church, if you could even call it that, who will not crack open their Bible because it might offend some people. Because it's too fundy. But on the other side of the things, I've had conversations where I've talked about the prophets, and I've talked about the gospels, and I've talked about the teachings in both, and people argue saying that it's too liberal, too progressive. And I'm like, but that's scripture. That's literally word. I'm quoting scripture here. But they want to argue. But the thing that they fail to realize is that this reveals the nature of our Savior. From Genesis to Revelation, it reveals the nature of our God. The nature we are supposed to emulate. You realize that, right? We're not just supposed to read it. We're supposed to act the way Jesus did. We're supposed to find the character of God within these pages and reflect it. From Genesis, where God is revealed as the creative one, with care and with beauty, to Revelation, where God is judging the sins of the world. When God is calling Israel the holiness and the prophets, to when Jesus is walking with his disciples and showing love and compassion to the woman caught in adultery. Every moment in Scripture reveals the nature of our God, reveals his heart for his creation. And it is that nature and that heart that we are to emulate. So what now? When I saw that video, my first response was anger. My first response was, how dare they even call themselves Christians if they want to disregard the word of Jesus? But then I realized something. My responsibility in that moment is not to condemn those people that would dare say such an appalling thing. My responsibility is to share the truth. And that truth, regardless of where in Scripture it still reveals the nature of God. And so if the nature of God is seen as too fundamentalist, then you know what? Let me be fundamentalist. Let me appear fundamentalist to the people who see the truth of God, the word of God, as too fundamentalist. Let me be that way. And if the people see the truth of God's word and the content of God's word as too woke, well, you know what? I'll wear that title to those people. I'll be too woke. If it's seen as too rough, I'm still going to keep preaching the truth. So I will be rough to those people. I might try to be a little bit more gentle when interacting with them in person, just so I don't build a wall that's unnecessary between them and Jesus. But you know what? I'm not going to stop preaching that truth. And if it's seen as too weak, well then, I'll just be weak. I will bear all of those titles, all of those labels, for the sake of doing what God's word tells me to do, and for the sake of reflecting the nature of God. Because if Scripture's purpose is to teach, we must let it teach. And if it is to reprove, let it reprove me. If it's to correct, let me embrace that correction. Let us all embrace that correction. And if it's to train us in righteousness, then let it train us. Let us all be more righteous. Let us reflect God better. Let us be more like Jesus. Jesus never let the labels bother him. So we must not let the labels bother us. Instead, let us just reflect our Jesus. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the truth of your word today. I thank you that we have the truth of your word today. I thank you for the fact that this scripture is available to us today, despite those who have tried to make it irrelevant. God, we know that the truth of your word is relevant, and we know that it is applicable, and we know that it reveals your nature. Lord, help us reflect that nature as we go about our daily lives. And help us not to filter the truth. In order for us to avoid those labels that we might despise. Help us to be reflections of you, God, unfiltered. And help us to emulate your holiness. God, I ask that as we go about our week, that you instill in our hearts the desire to dig into your word and get to know you better. So that we can be your reflections to our world and accurate ones. Bless us and keep us. In your precious and holy name, amen. You are dismissed.